And that's why I'm really honored today to have the chance to introduce somebody who frankly really needs no introduction. She's been a hero to the taxpayer forever, fought for the taxpayer's Bill of Rights. She's a tax lawyer, federal tax lawyer, started her own business. We all know who she is, and we all know that the Democrats are obsessed with her. Nancy Pelosi and the largest liberal PAC have already targeted her defeat in 2014. And you know what? If you thought what they did to Norm Coleman, if you thought what they did to the Minnesota legislature in the last couple of election cycles was something, well, just wait until you see what they unload on Michele Bachmann in 2014, and it's already started. She's consistently fought for what is right, and the liberals hit her. They're playing as dirty a political game as you can possibly get, and it's no mystery that their candidate against her came up the same week that the false claims against her in Washington, D.C. came up. So you know what? We're going to stand by Michele Bachmann. So let's please welcome our hometown hero, Michele Bachmann.
Years. And it was sad that her passing did not receive receive the attention that it should have. But her legacy continues to live on, and her legacy and her example will continue to lead on. Because of her efforts, coupled with Ronald Reagan, coupled with the Pope, they were able to defeat the great totalitarianism of their time. And that was communism throughout the world. They did it because they made the case against socialism. And they did it so well. And Margaret Thatcher knew the difference between right and wrong when it came to economics. She was no one's fool. She was principled, and she was willing to engage the debate, which is what we are doing by being gathered here today. And the speakers that have come before me today, and the other speakers who will come, have been engaged in the debate. And those who are willing to stand up for you, whether it's here at the state level or at the federal level, we need to support them at every possible turn, because they are the only thing standing between us and complete and utter control by an out of control centralized state or federal government. Minister. Let me just lay the context of the environment that Margaret Thatcher ran in. During that time, the United Kingdom had just doubled the number of private industries that the UK had nationalized. They saw a doubling in the increase of prices that the consumer was paying. There was a doubling in the rate of inflation. There was a doubling in the rate of unemployment. Sound familiar? That's the environment that Margaret Thatcher chose to engage the debate, just like Ronald Reagan chose to engage the debate during the time of Jimmy Carter, when we saw similar statistics. And what I would like to do is read from some of Margaret Thatcher's words in 1977. And because I am now past my prime, in service to my country, I'm going to put on my reading glasses. She said that when we speak about socialism, we must not focus only on the material, financial aspects of socialism, but instead we need to focus on the central heart of the evil nature of socialism, which is moral. So listen to her words. She said, "We must not focus our attention exclusively on the material, because though important, it is not the main issue. The main issues are moral. In warfare, said Napoleon, the moral to the material is as 3-1. That's in motivating a person to act. You may think that in civil society the ratio is even greater. The economic success of the Western world is a product of its moral philosophy and practice." You see, Margaret Thatcher was a big fan of us, of America in the Western world. And England at that time was called the sick man of Europe. She was unwilling to see her beloved country stay in a state of perpetual decline. And that's why she fought with her words and with her spine to rescue her country from the moral abyss that they were in. She said the economic results are better because the moral philosophy is superior. It is superior because it starts with the individual, with his uniqueness, his responsibility, and his capacity to choose. Surely this is infinitely preferable to the socialist statist philosophy, which sets up a centralized economic system to which the individual must conform. That's what the current majority here in the Capitol in St. Paul are trying to do to you. It is one-party rule, and they want you to conform to their will here in St. Paul. Margaret the United Kingdom. She said that when you are subject to a centralized economic system to which the individual must conform, that subjugates you, that directs you, and it denies you your right to free choice. Because choice is the essence of ethics. If there is no choice, if you have no choice, like we will not get in Obamacare, no choice in our health care, there will be no ethics. There will be no good. There will be no evil. Good and evil have meaning only insofar as man is free to choose. Choice in a free society implies responsibility on the part of the individual. There is no hard and fast line between economic and other forms of personal responsibility to self, to family, to your business, to your community, to your nation, to God. Morality lies in choosing between feasible alternatives. A moral being is one who exercises his own judgment in choice on matters great and small, bearing in mind their moral dimension, right and wrong. Insofar as his right and duty to choose is taken away by the state, the party, or the union, his moral faculties, his capacity for choice, atrophy. They go away. And he becomes a moral cripple in the same way as we should lose the faculty of walking, reading, seeing, if we are prevented from using them over the year. The socialists would take away most or all of these choices. A man would do what he was told by the state or by his union, work where work was found for him, at the rate fixed for him, and the degree of effort permitted for him. He would send his children to school, where the education authority decided what the children would be taught and the way they are taught, irrespective of the parents' views. Sound familiar? Yeah. He would live in the housing provided by the state. He would take what he could get, give what he was obliged to give. This does not produce a responsible or a moral society. This does not produce a classless society. On the contrary, it produces the most stratified of all societies, divided into two classes, the powerful and the powerless, the party bureaucratic elite and the manipulated masses. And are these rulers better fitted to make choices on our behalf or to dispose of our resources? Are they wiser, less selfish, more moral? What reason have we for supposing that they are? You see, that is the point. We lose the essence of who God made us to be. Moral beings, capable of choice, inherently able to defend ourselves and our families. And that's why what is happening in St. Paul is so morally reprehensible. When we are denied our right to keep and bear arms, when we are denied our right and our capacity to make choices for ourselves and for our families economically and over the moral values that we choose to embrace within our own families and for our children. You see, this is the moral issue of our time. And just like we saw one party rule and dominate here in the state of Minnesota, I'm here to tell you that there is no fear among that party about the White House. They know it is theirs for the next 4 years, and they are using it to their advantage. They are not fearful that they will lose their stronghold over the United States Senate. They believe without a shadow of a doubt that Harry Reid will maintain his grip on the United States Senate. You see, all the President of the United States needs is to defeat 17 members of the House of Representatives. And the ink wasn't even dry on his election certificate when he took his powerful billion-dollar campaign apparatus and turned it into the campaign machine will say right now, we will never again be the same country if they are victorious and take the House of Representatives. This is that serious. We saw what happened to our brave soldiers last September 11th in Benghazi, Libya. Never forget Benghazi, Libya. Because while, unfortunately, we will not have the White House for the next 4 years, we cannot allow one-party rule to come in the last 2 years of this president's administration. That's why we saw the unprecedented fight we did. Minnesota was ground zero in the year when the Senate went to 60 votes. $20 million was spent in this state with lie after lie after lie stated about our Senator Norm Coleman, who had served us well in this state. But they needed that vote. Why? Because that's how they gave you Obamacare. That's how they gave you Dodd-Frank. That's how they're continuing to have this economic malaise that we are in right now. You see, so much is at stake. The president wants to bookend his presidency by having one-party rule the first 2 years and one-party rule the last 2 years. Because I'm here to tell you what they'll do. They will change the rules of the Senate. It now requires 60 seats to be filibuster-proof. They will change it to a simple majority of 50 votes with Joe Biden as the tiebreaker. And every part of their agenda, taking away our gun rights, dealing with immigration, every issue you can possibly imagine will pass on that watch. And now it's up to us to make sure that Barack Obama does not achieve his goal of one-party rule by losing any of the three Republican seats that we have in the state of Minnesota. This is what we can do. If you want to know what we can do, flip the two House seats back here, flip the governorship here. We need to do that, but under no circumstances can we lose one of the three Republican congressional seats here in Minnesota, because our nation is depending upon us to hold on to those seats. You see, so much